us, beckons us to come and to look, to behold. And so Jesus is called the Rose of Sharon. But he's also the Lamb of God, because the controversy is between good and evil. And there is a good, and there is an evil, beloved. These are the two things that have been misconstrued and over which mystery has been enshrouded. Satan has sought to hide the character of good, which is God, to misconstrue it. But he is also, in order to make sure that that is successful, he has enshrouded his own character and cloaked it about with supposed goodness. And this is the great controversy. Satan has accused God of being like he is. And Satan has claimed to be like God is. And his deception has gone out into the universe. And God has determined that the truth of the matter shall be known. And this is why we are involved in the great controversy. And two things must be clearly understood for us to be able to stand in these last days. For Satan is going to come. And all who do not understand this will be deceived at his appearing. The great controversy revolves around the character of God and the character of Satan. We must understand both. We must understand God, which is good. We must understand what goodness is and know to call it by its right name. We must understand what evil is and be able to call it by its right name. Turn with me to Matthew 18, 1 through 3. It tells us in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18, verses 1 through 3, at the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" An important question. They were asking for all the wrong reason, but a question that we ought to know. Who is greatest? Notice how Jesus answers. Verse 2, he's silent. He doesn't give a direct answer, does he, immediately? But he does something rather strange, exceedingly strange to the disciples. It says, and Jesus beckoned a little child unto him. And what did that child do? Came. That was an object lesson. And set him in the midst of them. And now notice what he says. Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted, and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. What does this have to do with the great controversy? This is the key to heaven. Isn't that what he said? Except ye be converted, and become as little children, ye shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. There's the key. There's how we ascend that ladder. But if we are to become as little children, how is that going to secure us an entry into heaven? Because it answers those two mysteries. If you understand a child. Children have not been, a child has not had their character shaped and molded like we have, has not had their nature perverted by sin, has not had their eyes blinded by sin. They see good for good and evil for evil. A child knows it and recognizes it for what it is. And every one of you know it. And that's why Jesus used a child as an example. But if we call children sinners, what are we saying about entering heaven? The Bible was not written for children. It was written for those to whom Jesus spoke. He set the child in the midst of adults. Amen. That's for whom it was written. Those were the ones that needed to be converted and changed into little children. It's written for you and me. Why? Because in seeing that little child, we were to behold the Lamb of God. What real innocence is, what that real perfection of character is, that character never left Jesus. Jesus was always a child in that sense. He was not childish. But when he became a man, childish things were put away. And I don't think childish things ever had a place in Jesus' life. But for us, we must come to the point like the Apostle Paul. We must put those things away, childish things. But does that mean we stop being a child? Some of us think so. But we become an adult, right? Do you know what adult means? Do you know what adultery is? Do you know how you adulterate something? You corrupt it. You pollute it. Are you an adult? Or are you a child?
Child of God.
Behold the Lamb. What is a lamb? Did it say, behold the Ram of God? Lamb. Child. If it were a goat, behold the kid. Let's behold the Lamb of God. Isaiah 53, verses 1 through 12. I want you to read them with me. I want them to sink into your heart. Because Isaiah beheld the Lamb of God, and he was bidden right. Right, which you have seen. But the question is, as he puts in the beginning, who hath believed our report? Who hath believed is the question. For the report is there. And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant. What does tender mean?
Young.
And as a root out of dry ground, he hath no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. I read that in our last meeting. There was nothing in Jesus' outward form that drew us to him, but it was something inside him, that child. That drew us, that drew the crowds, that drew people. He is despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Notice that the prophet is including himself. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But affliction I shall add, I must add, should not rise up the second time. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb before the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul, us. And he shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death. And he was numbered with the transgressors and bare the sin of many. Will he bear your sin? Because right now that sin is being pled before the mercy seat. Now is the time to lay that sin at his feet, to give that sin to him, that that sin may be paid for. And one day, blot it out. The same Isaiah. Was given a vision of the great controversy. Perhaps not in words that we may recognize, but notice his language. Isaiah 5:20. Woe unto them that call what?
Evil good.
And good evil. That put darkness for light and light for darkness. That put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Notice verse 21. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. This is what leads them to the first. This is what leads us to call good evil and evil good, to put light for darkness and darkness for light. When we are wise in our own eyes and prudent in our own estimation, when we have failed to receive the wisdom and knowledge of God, when we have failed to see good for what it is and evil for what it is, when we have failed to behold the Lamb of God, only then shall we be wise in our own eyes. You see, this is the great controversy. And God pronounces a woe, not only a curse, but something to mourn and lament over. We read, according to the light that God has given me in vision. Now, of what matter is he speaking here? Opinion? We can know, can't we? She says, the light that God has given me in vision. This was something that God showed her. We can know, beloved. She says, continues, according to this light, wickedness and deception are increasing among the world.
No.
That's right. It says God's people who profess to keep his commandments. Spiritual discernment to see sin as it exists. This is why we are bidden to behold the Lamb of God, because that, beloved, is the price for sin. And then to put it out of the camp is decreasing among God's people. And spiritual blindness is fast coming upon them. You remember what the Apostle Peter said about those that lack these things? They are what? Blind. How then is this blindness coming upon God's people? The answer should be self-evident, shouldn't it? Cause and effect. The straight testimony must be revived. And it will separate those from Israel who have ever been at war with the means that God has ordained to keep corruptions out of the church. You know the means that God ordained to keep corruptions out of Israel? We'll take a look at it in a moment. Wrongs must be called wrongs. Grievous sins must be called by their right name. All of God's people should come nearer to him and wash their robes in the character of, robes of character in the blood of the Lamb. Then will they see sin in the true light and will realize how offensive it is in the sight of God. Who can know, in the moment of temptation, the terrible consequences which will result from one wrong, hasty step? Now notice, that's not a question. That is an exclamation. Who, beloved, can know? Can anyone tell me who can know? God. God knows, beloved. God knows what can take place in one moment of weakness, with one wrong decision, one hasty step. God knows the consequences, and those consequences are sin. And God ordained a means to engrave this lesson upon our minds. He saw what it would end in. And he gave us a means to secure that it should never happen again. Our only safety is to be shielded by the grace of God every moment and not put out our own spiritual eyesight so that we will call evil good and good evil. Without hesitation, diligence. With diligence, we might say, or argument, without hesitation or argument, we must close and guard the avenues of the soul against evil. That is our work, beloved. What was that system that God ordained? Remember those symbols? How and what they pointed to? They pointed to that system, that great sacrificial system that was instituted to teach us the lesson of sin. And I want to share with you a brief testimony of how I got it. When it clicked in my mind, there's an experience I'll never forget. And maybe some of you have had experiences that you will never forget. It was 5 years ago. I was in Fiji. on a mission trip. I was in the northern portion of Fiji, near a city called Nandi, and I was working in a little sanitarium. And we were there treating different families. And as I was working there, there came a family from India. There are many Indians on the island of Fiji, by the way. I believe half the population is Indian. And this Indian family came there. It was a mother, a father, and a number of children. And we were working with the mother, who was very ill and sick. And as I was doing different treatments, helping with different treatments for her, the children were over in a corner, and they were all huddled around one another, around the phone. And on their phone, they were able to somehow reach the internet, connect to the internet. And they were downloading movies and watching movies and things, and I could hear some of the silliness that was going on over there by the sound of the phone. And my attention was drawn over there, and I was thinking, Lord, how can I reach those children and help them to understand the danger? And as I was taking one of the buckets of treatment away, I passed by them, and I set it down, and they noticed my attention directed toward them. And they came over to me, and the one who had the phone, assuming that I was interested in what they were watching, stuck it in front of my face. I said, here, look. And what I saw made it click. What I saw was a Muslim execution of a man who was guilty of some crime. I don't remember what the crime was. The man was bound by his hands, and he was forcefully put upon the ground. And then a man took a knife, raised up his head, and slit his throat. And I watched as his lifeblood poured out, and the man struggled for his life till he could struggle no more. And I can't imagine what expressions were on my face, but I know what was in my heart. Pain. I saw death as I'd never seen it before. You know, I went to a pretty rough high school. Saw a lot of violence, a lot of bloodshed. But somehow this event came so near to me, watching this man die, and die a violent death, did something to me. It caused the meaning of the Lamb of God to click in my mind as never before. Why God instituted that system. Because that event horrified me. It sent thrills of horror through my soul as never before that will never be effaced. I can never efface that image from my mind. It's still there. It still haunts me sometimes. But it reminds me of the horror of sin. Because that is why God instituted the sacrificial system, beloved. He called upon man to slay an innocent animal, to shed its blood, so that that same thrill of horror, God didn't need to tell him by a loudspeaker. His having to participate in the result of his own sin was to teach him the lesson, was to be an object lesson. Now, no more do we have to shed blood to teach us that lesson. Thank God.
Amen.
But something else was instituted to teach us that lesson. Just before the cross of Calvary, it was instituted. And that was why that bottom symbol was there, the juice and the bread. Jesus gave us those symbols to teach us that very lesson. The two things we must understand. God's desire to give us his life, to help us understand what goodness is, and to help us understand what evil is and its cost. If we fail to understand these things, we shall never be as the little child. We shall never enter heaven. But we will never put sin out of our lives until we see how offensive it is in the sight of God. That image is so offensive to me that I can't erase it from my mind. And I pray that as we behold the Lamb of God, we will never be able to face it from our minds. Because that's why it's there. And that's why the verb is in the imperative. Behold. Don't stop. Behold the Lamb of God. Don't cease looking. Because the moment you do, your heart will become hardened. You will lose that first love. Turn with me to Matthew 7. You see, when we turn away from that, instead of directing our eyes inward and searching our hearts, we begin to look outward. And this is why Jesus spoke these words in Matthew 7, verses 1 through 3. Judge not that ye be not judged. For with what judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged. And with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, but considerest not the beam that is in thine own eye? Why is it that we do this? I'll tell you why. Because we are not beholding the Lamb of God. We have that beam still in our eye, that sin that has corrupted our minds and our hearts. And so that all we see is our own sinful, vile selves, and we compare everyone to that standard. And so we are led to judge others and not to judge ourselves. But if we want to be able to help others, and we are, according to this, to help others. Notice what Jesus says. How wilt thou say to thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thine eye, and behold, a beam is in thine own eye? How? The answer is given. Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye. And then shalt thou see clearly to cast the mote out of thy brother's eye. We are bidden to help our brother. But before we can help our brother, we must first help ourselves. This is why we need to learn to call sin by its right name and goodness by its right name, because otherwise we shall not see clearly to help our brother. Our judgment will be perverted according to our conception of sin. We will be wise in our own eyes. We will no longer be calling sin by its right name, but we will be calling it by our own name. This is why the language is given in Psalm 73. We're not going to read that whole psalm, but I would ask you, plead with you, read it, because it is the story of Asaph. This is the first psalm of Asaph, who was the chief singer in the Levitical choir under King David, who wrote these psalms. And in Psalm 73, he tells of how he once envied the wicked. He saw their prosperity, their health, all these things. And he said, I was almost fallen, I almost slipped and turned when I beheld the prosperity of the wicked, their seeming peace and security and happiness, having everything that heart could desire. And I coveted after that. I longed after the things of the world, he's saying. I was coveting after it. He had lost sight of the Lamb of God. His vision was blurred. But he says something in that chapter that I want you to note. We're going to read it. Just said one verse. Psalm 73. Verse 16. We'll start with, "When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me," he said. And then, verse 17, he says this, "Until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end."
Amen.
Then he understood his own end. Then he got it. And that beam was taken from his eyes. And that's why, four Psalms later, same author, Asaph, we read Psalm 77 and verse 13. The triumphant declaration of Asaph. "Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God?" As Joshua was leading the hosts of Israel to victory in the land of Canaan, something interrupted that victory. Do you know what that something was? Something interrupted, or someone, the troubler of Israel. Trouble? Where did we read about trouble or affliction? Do you remember?
Nahum.
And what did God say about that affliction? It shall not rise the second time. If we understand the story of Achan, we understand why. Notice what this story tells us. It's found in Joshua chapter 7, verses 12 and 13. "After this was understood that there was sin in the camp," verse 12, we read this, "Therefore the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but turned their backs before their enemies, because they were accursed." They had a woe upon them. Isaiah 5:20. One had saw what was evil and called it good, and took it for himself. It said, now notice what it says. This is God's word. "Neither will I be with you anymore, except you destroy the accursed from among you." Have you ever thought about that? God's word was strong, wasn't it? Unequivocally, God said, "I will no more be with you, except ye rid this thing out of the camp." We must learn, beloved, how to deal with sin. We must learn how to deal with iniquity, not only in the camp, but here first.
Amen.
Because if we haven't done it here first, we will never deal with it rightly in the camp. That was why God instituted the sanctuary service first, to teach them how to rid it out of their own lives, so that then they could rid it out of the camp. And what it must be done to rid it. It was to be an object lesson forever. Sin was to be seen in its right nature and what its cost was. It had to be, because God said, "I will not be with you anymore except you destroy the accursed from among you." We read, the Creator loves His creatures. God loves us. But this event was to teach this one thing. Pay very close attention. "But he who loves sin more than righteousness, error more than truth, perpetuates the transgression that brought woe into our world, and cannot be regarded with favor by the God of truth." The way of truth and righteousness involves a cross. A cross is the implement of death. Many misinterpret the requirements of God and make them mean anything that will not disturb their consciences or inconvenience them in their business relations. But truth is the only sanctifying medium. The love of God, as manifested in Jesus, will lead us to the true conception of the character of God. As we behold Christ pierced for our sins, and I pray you will forgive me if I add this, if we will behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world, we shall see that we cannot break the law of God and remain in His favor, just as God was trying to teach the children of Israel. We shall feel that as sinners we must lay hold of the merits of Christ and cease to sin. Then we are drawing nigh to God. As soon as we have a correct view of the love of God, we shall have no disposition to abuse it. And this is why I first shared the message on the Rose of Sharon, because we have to have that first. We have to have that first, beloved, before we can understand the nature of sin. We have to understand purity before we can understand the vileness of evil. A child understands. In closing, and I thank you for bearing with me, though I know you have not really born, but that your hearts rejoice like mine in hearing the word of God. In Revelation chapter 15 and verse 3, we find the end. Something very glorious is written here. But something that once we understand this great controversy, this verse all of a sudden makes sense. Revelation 15:3. And they, who are they? Let's look at verse 2. And I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. This is the they. Who are they?
Multitude,
144,000. Those that have been sealed. They, notice what they do. And they sing the song. I'm stopping there. You know what the word song means in Hebrew and in Greek? Song, if you look in the Old Testament, you'll find is often or joined together with prophesying. With poetry is a form of prophecy. All the Old Testament writers wrote in poetry. Did you know that? All of them. It's all poetry. Because when you're inspired, that's what comes out. You see, a song is inspired. It's an experience. And that's why we sing those hymns, because those people were writing out their experiences, and we sing them because we have made them our own. If you haven't, then you're singing just hot air. God wants us to make those hymns our own, those experiences, these songs. And that's why the 144,000 who understand this sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. Because that experience is now theirs. Why Moses? Why is Moses included in this? If you look in the Bible, I think you'll find there's only one other man who went through a similar experience and trial in his life that Jesus did. That man was Moses, who bore with probably the worst crowd on the face of the planet for 40 years. The worst group of people that you could possibly imagine to have to deal with for 40 years. And he was the man for the job. That's why it's the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. And it will be our song, beloved. Amen. If we will strive to be among that number, if we will come to Jesus and behold the Lamb of God, begin to understand His purity, His goodness, the goodness of God, and begin to understand the nature of evil and the author of evil, and learn to abhor it in our own lives. We need to behold the Lamb of God. And I don't have this in my notes, but this is why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, this is the very last verse, by the way, I want to leave you with this thought. In Matthew chapter 10, find the verse I'm looking for here. Somehow it lost me. Or I lost it, I should say. But that is why Jesus said to his disciples and to those before him, if any man hate not father or mother, he's not worthy of me. Any man hate not his son or his daughter, he is not worthy of me. If we love any man or woman or anyone on this earth more than we love Jesus, we are not worthy of Him. Why? Because God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. God didn't love Himself more than He loved us. And He set that example for us, that we ought to love Him with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And I believe that's what this is all about. And may God help us.
37.
Thank you, sir. I did have the right chapter. Verses 37 and 38, I believe. Thank you. I want to leave you with that thought. And may God bless you. May God keep you. May the God of heaven make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May He lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace.